Please stand for the prayer. Sisters and brothers, let us rejoice in the vision of John. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The old heaven and the old earth and the sea had disappeared. A great voice thundered from heaven. See, God is making God's home with mortals. God will live in with them, and they will be God's people.
Good morning. Welcome to everyone for worship today. I want to invite our children, our young people, to come forward and join me up here on the steps of the altar. While they are coming up, I just want to alert you all to make sure that if you have a loved one that you would like us to name and for you to place a candle and have a bell rung for a loved one who has died in the last year. If they are not listed in the bulletin, there's a slip at the back on the table where you came in. Come on up here, girls. Come on all the way up here. There's a slip to fill out to have your loved one's name read, and you would just bring that up at the appropriate time during our prayers. Come on through. Have a seat. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. You can come on around. We do have a cross with sand, and what else do you see in there? Seashells. It's a special Sunday today. Come on up. There's room right there if you'd like. Come on through. It's a special Sunday that's called All Saints Sunday, and we are going to remember people who have died in the last year in a special... Okay, that's all right. You can just sit down there if you want. That's okay. That'll be fine. Thank you. Glad you came up. So we're going to remember that, remember our loved ones in worship a little bit later. I want to talk to you about your Sunday school lesson this morning, and I brought in something to show. What is this? A piggy and a piggy bank, absolutely. And if I shake it a little bit, what are you going to hear? Money, coins, that's right. How many of you have piggy banks of some sort? They're not all shaped like a piggy, right? Okay. Yeah, this is kind of heavy. It's also got a crown on it, which I really love, right? And a little tutu on it. What are some of the banks that you have? Spider-Man and Marshall Bank. Awesome. Great. Well, banks come in all shapes and sizes, and today we're going to talk about money. It's often said that it isn't polite to talk about money, but Jesus talked about money quite a bit, actually, in his short time on earth. And so one time Jesus was in the temple in Jerusalem, and in the temple was like the biggest, fanciest sanctuary that the Jewish people could worship in. And it was the holiest place on earth. Jesus had been teaching large crowds of people, and when he was done, Jesus and the disciples rested in the temple, and they sat in this special area that was called the treasury. The treasury. They keep treasure in the treasury. What do you think some of that treasure might have been? Money, absolutely, you are right. And from there, Jesus could see the people putting their offerings in the box. And because they didn't have offering plates like we do today that get passed around. So Jesus watched people come and go and make their offerings to God in the treasury, and he saw many rich people come through and put in large amounts of money. Then he saw a widow, an older woman who was no longer married because her husband had died, come in, and she walked quietly up to the treasury box, and she put in two small coins and then quickly walked away. And the coins together were worth about one penny. One penny. That's what she put in. And do you know what Jesus says to his disciples about that one penny that woman gave? He said, "This woman has put in more than anyone who's contributing to the treasury." So some people put in large amounts of money, but they had even more money. This woman had almost nothing to give. And so for her to give that penny, it really cost her. She might not have eaten for a week because she didn't have that money. And Jesus said, "This is a wonderful way to live, giving all that she had." And she did that because she knew that she was blessed by God and that God would provide. So even if we don't have a lot, we all have something that we can share with those who have less than we do. And even though giving to others makes our piggy banks lighter, it makes us and God very happy when we give, okay? And when we help other people. Let's pray. Kind and generous God, you're going to repeat after me. Kind and generous God, help us to be generous too. Help us to share the good gifts you have given us with others so that all may know of your love and care. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may go to the entrance to the church sanctuary and meet your teachers for Sunday school. Thanks for coming up. Have a great class. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 25. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him, so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." The word of the Lord. The second reading is from Revelation chapter 21. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
please stand as you are able for the reading of our gospel. The Holy Gospel according to John, the 11th chapter. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Please pray with me. May the meditations of my heart and the words of my lips be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, and may you add a blessing to the hearing and understanding of this message today. Amen. This Sunday is a special Sunday. It's All Saints Sunday. We started by singing the glorious hymn for all the saints. Some of you have come here to honor and remember your beloved, especially if they have died this past year. For others, today's service is a ritual that comforts and brings us deeper into the mystery of life and death and life that we share with Jesus, our Savior. How did all of this get started? Why do we even have saints? How are saints determined? Who is a saint? I would say that saints are different than people we revere for their own success. One does not achieve sainthood by their own merits. In a saint, there is evidence of the life-giving spirit and the work of God in and through them that makes a person a saint. Nowhere was this more apparent than in the martyrdom days of the early church, where lives were lost because of their belief and the life in the risen Christ. So the church began a practice of celebrating the date of death of these martyrs, these saints in the fourth century. But we don't just have a service today that honors those who died or those who have been elevated to the level of saint. By the seventh century, the celebration of saints had expanded to include non-martyrs as well. And here at Covenant, we celebrate the saints as those who have died in the last year. What or who is a saint? I've heard a saint defined as a forgiven sinner, which pretty much makes us all saints and sinners at the same time. In several places in the New Testament, all believers are called saints. St. Paul wrote that believers are called to be saints. About the journey of a believer, about our journey toward sainthood, Martin Luther wrote, "We are not yet what we shall be, but we are growing toward it." Amen to that. We are growing toward sainthood, but we are not there yet. We are growing toward that day when there will be a new heaven and a new earth, but we're not there yet. We are growing toward a day when all our tears will be wiped away, but we're not there yet. We are growing, we are in the not yet time between the very good of God's creation and the full reign of the kingdom of God. We live in, exist in this not yet time and in between, an in-between time. We know the certainty and pain of death, but also strive to live the most of life here and now. And how to give witness to the promise of the resurrection without it dismissing the reality of death, the pain, and the grief. Our pursuit of justice and peace, of serving those in need, is not about earning eternal life after death, but always because they are a means by which death itself is overcome here and now. Today, in our world that witnesses mass shootings at schools, Halloween parties, malls. In our world that witnesses a crush of refugees seeking asylum from violence, loving the neighbor as yourself is the means by which we fight off death every day. And looking with the eyes of God, we are able to see the saints beside and all around us. Without this drive and passion, death whittles away at our lives, possibly even our faith. We allow death to have its way and a say before it should. We allow death to determine a way of being in the world that has acquiesced to the status quo, which then weakens the power of the kingdom of God that comes near. And finally, we allow death to have more power than resurrection. Today, we hear the good news story of Mary and Martha and Lazarus. A not yet time for Lazarus, Mary, Martha, and those who grieved Lazarus, and a not yet time for Jesus too. A time when they all came face to face with death, grief, life, and faith. The story is much longer than we read today. Before our reading started, Mary and Martha sent word to Jesus that his friend Lazarus was very sick and dying. Jesus doesn't immediately go to them, saying that the delay is so that all will believe. When he does arrive, Lazarus has died. Martha runs to him and says, with a tone that is part accusing and part expectation, "If you had been here, he wouldn't have died." And then Mary says the same thing. Then the crowd said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" All bold statements of faith in the midst of their grief, a grief that Jesus shared and made him weep, a not yet time that Jesus experienced, and one that I believe he experiences over and over with us when we grieve. Who among us has not had a not yet time and said, "If you were with me, Lord, he wouldn't have died. Jesus, why didn't you save my love? Why weren't you here for my brother? Why weren't you here for my beloved? If you had been here, Jack, Simon, and Evan wouldn't have died at the hands of a drunk driver. If you had been there, people wouldn't die of Lou Gehrig's disease. If you had been there, George Floyd wouldn't have died from police brutality. If you had been there, our friend wouldn't have died from suicide. If you had been there, men, women, and children wouldn't die crossing the border to find a better life." In our grief, we cry out for Jesus. And Jesus is still delayed. Or is he? If we look at the Bible, what we see is that we don't have any stories of Jesus keeping someone, not even himself, from dying. What we do have are stories of Jesus restoring life to someone who has already died. So we proclaim not that Jesus keeps people from dying, but that physical death is temporary. We proclaim physical death does not separate believers from God. In this broken world, in this not yet time, death happens. Suffering, trauma, injustice are. But Jesus is able to bring us through and give us new life on the other side. This is what we proclaim, and we don't do it alone. Just as Mary and Martha weren't alone in their grief, just as Lazarus did not take off his own grave clothes to resume life, neither are we alone. The gift of faith allows us to see God where others do not. Our community of faith, our family and friends surround us. The gift of faith allows us to see they are Jesus for us. Jesus is not late, not delayed, not absent, but present in those who gather with us. We are not alone. When the grief is too much, the trauma too deep, the suffering too long, there is a community filled with holy people surrounding each of us as trudging our way toward sainthood. It is faith, not doubt, that allows us to confess that Jesus triumphs over death, even as we reel from the grief and sadness of the one who has died. The whole story of the raising of Lazarus is for us to realize that resurrection is not just our future promise, but our present reality. And it is faith that allows us the hope and confidence in our reunion with our beloved dead one day. It is faith that opens us to the work of the Spirit in our lives. It is faith that leads us to believe that we too may live and die in the triune God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Eternal God, you hold firm amid the changes of this world. Hear us now as we pray for the church, the world, and everyone in need.
Merciful God, we give thanks for all missionaries who have brought your message of hope to new communities and wiped away tears. Continue to raise up courageous missionaries to share your gospel of hope. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating God, we praise you for abundant harvests and goodness of creation. Create communities of care for your earth. So that all land, water, and soil will be celebrated and cherished by future generations of saints. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of peace, we give you thanks for nations of peace that serve as a refuge for all whose homelands are afflicted with violence, and strengthen those who continue to work for peace and support all veterans who carry the scars of war. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of healing, we give you thanks for the healthcare workers who labor around the clock to answer cries for help. Bring wholeness to all who struggle with the post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety, depression, addiction, and all who long for healing in any way, especially those fighting COVID, cancer, and other illnesses. And Eli and his family, Kim, and all who love her. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of justice, we praise you for the feeding ministries and for the meals that bring people together for nourishment and fellowship. Bless chefs, bakers, servers, dishwashers, communion assistants, and meal ministry coordinators. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of the ages, we give you thanks for the saints of this congregation who have inspired, challenged, loved, and taught us. Do we have a family or loved one here for Emil Dahl? You may be seated. Maureen Rand. John Pritchard. Eugene George. Jane Anderson. Marilyn Nelson. Fanny Martin Dulk. Barbara Austin. Donna Pro. Leon Vagi. Robert Schwartz. Joni Pro. Earl Fossen. David Stronach Sr. Donald Heil. Peggy Eagle. Darlene Darlene Anderson. Russell S. Milland. Clyde and Jean Coakley and Marcia Coakley. Mark Holliday. Richard McCallum. Irene Anderson. Wilma Baumbach. Wipe away our tears and lead us by their example until we feast together on your holy mountain. Hear us, O God. God, our protection and strength, we entrust to you all for whom we pray. Remain with us always through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Please stand as you are able for our confession and forgiveness. Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter, like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share a sign of peace with one another. A couple of announcements today. Again, a warm welcome to everyone who is with us today and always, delightful to welcome our children back from downstairs. Today, the flowers are given in memory of Ingrid Thompson, given by Ingrid Thompson in memory of and celebration of her mother's birthday. The social action team will meet Monday night. Education team is meeting on Tuesday evening. Confirmation on Wednesday. What else are we going to put in here this week? It's great.
I also want to note just a brief mention of the stewardship campaign and pledge drive that is happening now. The goal of our stewardship drive is to help God's people grow in your relationship with Jesus through the use of your time and talents and finances. Other announcements. As we move into Holy Communion, just an invitation to make sure that you have your cup of juice and wafer. If you do not, raise your hand and the ushers will bring them to you. Would you please stand now as you are able? The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Gathered into one by the power of the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. A feast of love is offered here for you and for all the saints. If you would peel back the first layer of your cups to reveal your wafer. The body of Christ given for you. And the next layer to reveal your juice, the blood of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Blessed Jesus, at this table, you have been for us both host and meal. Now send us forth to extend our tables to share your gifts until the day when all feast together at your heavenly banquet.
Amen. People of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life to a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Led on by the saints before us, go in peace to serve the Lord.